Assalamu alaikum rahmatullah. Dear viewers, welcome back again. If you are just joining us now, we are talking about how to upbring our kids, or father's role in upbringing kids. So inshallah, you can join us, you can call us and share your ideas and your experiences, well, inshallah. So I'll first go to Abul Bashir Bhai again, to you, sir. You're a young man, mashallah, you're doing very well. And do you feel like we are struggling, you know, putting more time with our kids, like homework or taking them out? Do you feel like that? Because there are a lot of young people actually up to bad things. You know, they're up to no good. Drugs and gang fight and knife, this and that and that. There's something wrong. So what do you think?
We are struggling big time, yes. We are struggling to be with our kids all the time. We are more into tablets, computers, and PlayStations and things like that. Just things like you have to interact with your kids, otherwise they're going to get into bad crowds. There is lots of bad people out there. You can get involved easily. Kids can get involved easily as well. And the time would go quickly if you don't get involved with your kids and do the things that you should do, and not spend time with your mobile tablets and computers.
So when you were growing up, did you need a guide or did you just, fine, I'm okay?
No, we had
guides. What were the issues in your days then?
Well, in my days, I didn't go far away. I was bottom of the building, and we used to play football majority of the time. So our parents knew where we were. They could see us from the windows. Yeah. But nowadays, we can't send our kids outside by themselves. It's too dangerous out there. We have to take them out ourselves. There's no secure place for the kids to play unless you take them out to the park. You know, you can't tell them to go there by themselves, and it's not good. It's like, it's dangerous if you're unsafe.
It's true. Gerard, if I come to you, sir, you know, it's not that one solution. You know, our kids could be, you know, one can be very easygoing, another one can be very tough to do with. So how do we learn to interact with our kids? Yeah. And how do we make strong bondings? Because you also have a kid yourself.
Yeah, I've got three children, and they're very different. And you see that, and I've made the mistakes of wanting one to be the same as the other, because one, you know, she can sit down and read happily on her own, whereas my son, he doesn't enjoy reading as much, and I can put that unfair expectation on him. I think it's important to give them opportunities to experience different things in life as a parent, to take in places and to see the kind of things that they enjoy, and then beginning to give them the opportunity to go and do those things as a parent so that they can kind of enjoy life.
What do you find the most challenging?
Do I find the most challenging? As a parent, I think comparing. I think I compare a lot. I compare myself with other people a lot, and I see people who may be achieving more, and I say, like, well, I need to be there, and I can put that expectation on my children. So if I take my children swimming and I see a child who's slightly better swimmer than my child, I can be very easily drawn into the thing where I want you to be a better swimmer than that child, because I want my child to be the best. And I can, rather than just love my child for who they are, it's kind of, you need to be this to earn my love.
Would you push them to do something that I want to do?
I think it's important to push.
You might know it's better for him, but would you push that boundary?
I definitely think it's important to push your children so they know they don't. So that they know that life isn't just given to them; they need to earn things. But I think you have to be careful as well, not to push too hard when it's clearly not working.
If I come to Robert Scott, sir, you have a lot of experience with your kids. You've been in a lot of different countries of the world, and you've seen things differently. I'm sure you pick up the goodness from everywhere else. If you don't have a routine at home, routine means some style of doing some progress. Do you think it's a difficult area to people to work on, or do you think everyone needs some kind of planning for the kids? And
I think as a family, personally, I think we do. My wife and I and our three children, I think we work better when there is structure. Interesting, just from what Gareth's saying about different children doing different things, particularly our sun need structure. It's very interesting. He wants to know what is happening in the day, and it just provides him much more security to know those kind of boundaries.
How old is he?
He is 9, and our daughters are 11 and, and 13. But we try to start the day together as much as we can. My wife and I will get up a bit earlier to pray, to read the Bible, and then we'll have breakfast together as a family. So we at least start the day together and hopefully talk about what the day might be holding for us. Does that always happen? No, because we can be as chaotic and as tired and impatient with one another as anybody else. But that's how we try to start. And then the girls go off to school, and then one of us will take our son to school. And at the end of the day, try to eat together again. Again, well, how did the day go? You were worried about this, worried about that. How did that go? Again, it doesn't always happen because they might have girl guides for our daughters or cubs, timings change. But we try to do things together. And me as a father, to try to take a lead in things, to be interested and to show responsibility towards them. Again, it's much easier to let my wife do it because I just prefer to sit and eat my meal and then go on to the next thing. But it's important to take responsibility. And just picking up what Baz said about screens, we've said just a rule, it's not set in stone anywhere, but no screens at the table, even for the grown-ups. That's hard to keep if you want to check emails or you want to have a phone call, but say, no, actually, it's the people around me that are important at this point to talk and catch up.
So rule for everybody.
We try to, yes.
Is that how you, when grown up, is that how you learn? Like, is that something you learn from your when you were younger, or is something you adapt to it?
I think it's a bit of both. I think my parents were very hospitable people. We often had people coming in and out of the home, and our meal tables were often shared with other people. So meals were important. I don't remember that, them being quite as rigid about timings. And as Baz said, there weren't screens around in quite the evidence that, as there are now to distract us from one another. But it's the people, and it's forming character that is more important. It's helping our children to grow up, to make good decisions, good choices, because we're not always going to be there for them. At the moment, we do make decisions for them and help them to know what to do, but we're not always going to be there for them. And at this stage, we want to help them to form a good character that can make right choices in the future when they do leave our four walls of the home.
You've been to Sylhet in Bangladesh, so you've been there for quite a long time, 18 months, you said. And what have you seen difference from there? What did you learn from there? What did it teach you?
So before we went, our Bangladeshi friend said, oh, it's going to be so free for your children there. We didn't really know what that meant. But it was, partly because we were homeschooling them rather than going to a state school. But there was more freedom. There wasn't the fear of them going out like there could be here.
If you could explain homeschooling, it'd be good for our viewers, just to understand what it means.
So we went to learn Sylheti language as much as possible to be able to communicate better with our neighbours living in Tower Hamlets. And we went to language school together, but our children still needed to do the kind of schooling they'd be getting back here because we knew we were coming back. And so my wife and I, we taught them through English and maths, and then we would pick up other things that we found interesting that they might find interesting. So for my wife is very good at science, she's a doctor, and so she would teach kind of science and nature in Bangladesh. Look at the trees, look at the birds, and that kind of thing. I like history, so we'd teach something of the history of Bangladesh. So we do a bit of language school in the morning, and then a bit of homeschooling in the morning and afternoon as well. And again, children are different. Not all of our children took very well to homeschooling. So a couple of them did. And it's interesting, there's just a dynamic there, how in some sense you change from being a parent to teacher and how your children relate to you. But we wanted to take responsibility for our children's education. We're very glad we're back here now, and teachers can do that. But we mustn't abdicate our responsibility
for our
children.
What do you think they do differently with their kids in Bangladesh? Because I'm Bangladeshi, I will say positive stuff. I want to learn what you think they do differently.
I think that there seem to be much more rigidity. So children very much knew their roles within the family, when they were to speak, when they weren't to. And I think that tracked through to adulthood. I think people had many more responsibilities and duties to other people within the home and outside than maybe we have within our family. But people knew that. Now I can think, well, that's just enclosing people, encasing people, making them fit a role that's not for them. But in many ways, it was very good to help the family function well. I think we learned something from our individualistic culture here about community there, about the importance of always having people around to help, to be backup, to be supporting and serving one another. That the danger is when you kind of enforce duty and enforce serving, it doesn't come from the heart. So, oh, you must do that for me. Well, no, that person should out of desire from their heart rather than because you are telling them to.
How did it treat you when you were there?
Very well. Yeah, we enjoyed being there. We had some very good neighbours who looked after us, who looked out for us, who would be very helpful. We were talking about it with our children recently.
How much Bangla did you learn then? I'm Sylheti as well, so it's much better.
Yeah.
Okay, so when we're talking to people, you speak in Sylheti with them?
As much as possible, to try and learn the language to be of use here, but also the culture and the values, some of which are good, some of which are bad, just like here. Not everything is good but by any stretch, but there are things that we can learn from, and I think the community aspect, I think we found very challenging.
Brilliant. Football again.
Yes.
Father's football.
Yes.
So, why football? Why not something, anything else? Or you thought people are more interested in football?
I think if it could be several different sports, but I think if you go around Tower Hamlets, go around England, go around the world, football is the most played game there is, and it brings people together, and it's just quite as proof of that. Wherever you go, and I think the project that we run, it kind of shows that it does work. I think you could do it with other sports, but I love football, and the guys that come seem to love football, so that's why we...
I think it's been easier because the kids also play football, so yes. You can link up, and it's more like a bonding, it's already there.
Football is like everything, it's everything, entertainment, it's everything there in football, exercise as well, so yeah, it's better.
And it's the team element too, that's not just an individual sport, but you are being together, sharing the same space, helping one another, and supporting one another.
Yeah.
So how many people in your team? Do you play a proper team or do you play...?
So we run the project 3 days a week. On a Monday and Tuesday, alternate weeks, we run it on the Isle of Dogs, and we get about probably 30 to 40 dads that are on the list, but each week we get about 20. And then on a Wednesday we play at Mile End. And then on a Thursday, we played at Stepney Green Park, where we did today, and we had about 24 people coming to play today. And it's a real mixture of ages, ethnicities, religions, and it's a good place to be.
What do you think is the strength of mix of people and the weakness? What do you think is the strength?
What do I think the strength?
Yeah,
I think
because there's quite different kind of people are coming together, religious, not religious at all. I know they're all men's coming together. But what are the strengths you think?
Like we say, it produces teamwork that comes out of it and the community comes out of it. So we don't just do the football. Outside of the football, we have meals together. We have trips together.
Mm.
So we go. So we try once a term to have a meal. Once a term, we try and do trips. We're doing father children trips as well. So
plus
tournaments as well. So there's 30. A lot just going around the football, that he's trying to do. So the four main aims were, one was to kind of work on fitness. Health is a big problem across the country, in Tower Hamlets, and we want people to live a healthy lifestyle. We also want people to engage in their communities and just be a part of their communities, whatever your background, whatever your age, just to come together. And we want to engage with our schools more and give dads the opportunity to engage more, because fathers, they're not engaging as much as the mothers will in their schools, and then also just engage more in the children's lives.
Can I ask you a difficult one? Because I asked him for strength. If I ask you for weaknesses, is there any weakness or no? Is no weakness?
No,
there are a lot of people. How do you control them? There are lots of fathers. You know, the timing.
They could be
going together somewhere. What are the weaknesses you think?
There are some weaknesses, like we Asians, we start speaking Bengali sometimes, and we should speak English.
Because everybody understands English.
They should understand what we're saying. But this sometimes becomes the creative problem. But we resolve it afterwards. But it's natural thing, like for Asians, when we Asians gather around, we suddenly speak Bengali. It's a normal thing, but you know, some people...
So how do you overcome? Do you tell them, please? How do you overcome
We tell them, like, we're sorry, but it's a natural thing. It comes out. Bengali comes out automatically when we're speaking to another Bengali guy or anyone like that. We just speak Bengali, it just naturally comes out. And yeah, some people, they find it bad, thinking probably we're speaking on, you know, something negative about them, or, you know.
He speaks Bengali, so what's going on?
If I would speak anything Bengali, he would understand, so I can't say anything.
Have you told them, look, be careful, you can say something. We have people who know Bangla as well. Robert, you said father plays a role in the home. What kind of woman play a role in the home? Is there particular reasons or just
traditional? I think both mothers and fathers play a role in the home. I think if you look at just statistics, say that a child generally does better at school, generally does better with emotional development if both a mother and a father are involved in child's upbringing. That's not to say that they could never develop without one, but that's the kind of the best.
Because myself, a religious person, yourself as well, so the accusation of non-faith people will say, look, you guys always try to treat yourself something better than the woman. So the man plays a role in the home. He is the leader of the home. Is that something?
I think all people everywhere, no matter what their background, are prone to get things wrong, are prone to abuse other people in different ways, mentally, emotionally, physically. I think there's a danger too that in our culture, we think that if we say a man should lead, people hear that as you will oppress women. Well, no, that's not what's there. So for example, in the Holy Bible, it talks about that the husband and the father leading his family in a sacrificial serving way. He's not leading them by ordering them what to do. He is serving them. He is giving up himself so that he can make his wife be the best that she can be, his children the best that they can be. There's a verse about children that says, fathers, discipline your children, but not to exasperate them, not to wind them up so much that they just refuse to listen to you anymore. And you're not disciplining them in order to make yourself feel good. I am the leader in this household, you must listen to me. But to help them to develop, to help them, from a Christian perspective, to know God and to live for him in this world that he's made.
Because there is a big issue of single mothers. There are a lot of divorces happening. And that's the new theme now, isn't it? A lot of divorces are happening. Yes. And they're ending up, the children are mostly ending up with the mothers. A lot of, you know, sadly. So they're losing out the father. So what can we do about it? Is there anything we can do? No, we can't do it.
I think it's very hard to
maybe need to make a mother's football team. To be fair.
I think we need to strengthen marriages. I think we need to help people to see that marriage is a commitment, is a promise through thick and thin, in sickness and in health, in poverty and riches, and that there is to be love and service towards one another. I mean, that's the pattern that we seek to follow as Christian people. Are we perfect in it? No, not by any stretch, but that's what we seek to do. I think because we've become a culture in which promises don't matter anymore, and I can move on to whoever, and sex and relationships where it's not really about marriage, we kind of open those floodgates, and that's led to a lot of dysfunction and sadness in a lot of families and brokenness. It's interesting, just when you asked before about what we learnt in Salette, and we didn't see many divorced or single parents households in that kind of way, but we did see households in which men were working in the Middle East, so that they were absent, or in which they had two or three families, and there was a real I think issue of the children there growing up without a father figure, just as there is here in London.
That's true, yeah. If I ask you, if you compare, when you were growing up, your expectation, and kids nowadays, their expectation, or the style of upbringing those kids, if you could...
For me...
Is it really different now, or do you think it was always like that?
I think it's definitely different, because times are moving on, and especially like with technology, as Baz was saying earlier, it's changed a lot. But I know growing up for me, I wanted my dad to be there, and I wanted my dad to kind of see me do things, and I don't think that expectation has changed, and I don't think that expectation will ever change. I think children want, like a child wants their dad or their mother to read to them at night, to a bedtime story. They want them to take them to the park, they want them to take them swimming, you know, and I think we need to build up these roles, and just how important it is just walking your child to school, you know, picking your child up from school, seeing them in their school play, going to, like what Rob was saying, the parents' evening, just stuff like that. I don't think that will ever change. You know, things will move on in technology and stuff like that, but a child's heart is they want their father and they want their mother because that is what they've naturally been brought up. And if that is missing, then there's going to always be problems.
If I call you Buzz. Buzz, if I ask you, like internet, YouTube, and phone, and iPhone, young people, kids up to 6 years or 7 years old, everyone's got one on it. They are all day doing something, or at night, we don't know what's going on, unless you control them. It's taking them to another level, like bullying and all that stuff.
Yeah.
How do we control that?
Just have to educate them. Education is the key for everything. Mm. If you can give them good education, then I suppose they would learn. Mm. It's difficult.
Because as a football team, as a father's football team, we can ask another, how do you do it in your home? Mm. If you've got to know how to do it, or it works, I could do the same in my home as well. Yeah. So like we always could learn, because like education has to be...
Like Rob said just earlier on, he tries to eat with them.
Yeah, kids. That's great.
I try to do that as well sometimes. Sometimes it doesn't work out. I know that it's very hard for the kids. Mm. I got three boys, and not all of them mind the same. One would come and sit near me and eat with me, and I would say, no, my mom needs to feed me. Mom has to feed him. So it's like that. And one probably playing tablet, he's not getting off. You have to tell him to come, eat, or, you know, it's very hard. They just want to, they just don't want to interact.
So did you ever ask one of your teammates that, listen, this is the issue in my home.
Yeah.
As a friend, because you guys are playing together. What do we do? What do you do in your home? How do you stop these guys getting into bullying? Because through this, the bullying became, it's really worse. Mm. One person, remember, he killed himself in a few months ago.
Yeah.
And it's still there. There's a lot of issues around. So. Yeah.
I showed my son this clip and I told him, listen, son, that's what's happening in the world. You never should bully anyone in your life. Never get involved in gangs or drugs. Mm. This is what ends up. The boy just died because he was bullied for no reason. So never get involved. If you get bullied ever, tell your teacher or tell me straight away. Don't hide yourself. Never. That's what I tell my kids. And my older one, he questions so much, you know, and I do answer majority of them, yeah.
Okay, you know the bonding within your team. Mm. So if someone's not well or someone's ill or someone has a broken leg, how do you deal with that? How do you... you don't leave him in the field, I'm sure. I'll see you, mate. I'm going. How do you deal with those kind of stuff? Because it's quite nice to see 24 adults playing together and looking after
I think that's what's been really nice. Recently, I got injured and people were concerned. They didn't just leave me on the pitch. I couldn't play for the next few weeks, but people kept in touch. How are you doing? What's going on? And Gareth, think of you supporting that man who couldn't come after his wife died. How just to help people through those kinds of bad times. I think there is a real support and encouragement and a love and concern for people that you wouldn't ordinarily always find. And I think that's because people have become friends. Barriers have been broken down.
Would you like to share that, Gareth? How did you help this young man whose finger passed away?
It wasn't just me. No. I think it was a naturally...
Okay.
It was the whole group that just actually... This guy is a part of our team. He's our friend. So we as a group have a responsibility.
What's
to...
What's his name? Would you like to say...
We miss him, and if he is watching, Ishaque Uddin, and we miss him, and because of the circumstances, what's happened to him, it's meant he's had to stop playing, and you are always going to ask the question, you know, could we do more? And at times, I think that we could. So we're sorry, Allah, that you know if we haven't done as much as we should have done, but we want it to be a place where actually, if people are struggling, you know, with just whatever it may be, with health, with family, with children. It's a place where actually we as a group can say, you know, we want to get around you, we want to support you, we want to help you in every way we can. You know, if it means taking your children to school, taking them to clubs, that's what we would love to see happen. And it takes time, and it takes us to be vulnerable as well as individuals to stand up and say, you know what, I need help, which is a very hard thing for a man to do, to say you need help. But it's what we need to do sometimes.
Would they call you and say, I need this, I need help, I need that? Would they call you?
We have WhatsApp groups.
Okay.
And on the WhatsApp groups, people have definitely kind of shared things that are going on in their lives at the time. And they have, you know, straight away there has been responses to say, you know what, how is that going? You know, one gentleman had his car stolen, and straight away guys were straight away saying they were concerned and saying, you know, how's it going? I'm really sorry. You know, and just things, simple things like that can actually, there are people out there that care for me, that are kind of concerned for me, and it just, it helps.
That's good. What if you said to him, we play football, man, we don't look after your car? You could have done that. That's really amazing to see how they are bonding. It's more like a real close team, isn't it? I mean, without football, you couldn't get together these many people.
Yeah, I think this has provided the kind of the real vehicle for that to happen, for barriers to be broken down, for us to see that there are real people. I think, again, you can share the same space. We all live in Tower Hamlets, but you can be fearful of people who are different from you. But on the pitch, it's been great to get to know one another and going bowling together afterwards and speaking with each other, kind of just getting to know people that have real lives, real families, real issues, and aren't just scary people who look different or think differently from you.
Where do you see yourself in 5 years' time, that team itself? I mean, I'm sure you've got some plans to see. You've done it for a few years now. So where do you...
Be nice for my team to win once.
Okay,
that's one.
Who's in your team? Yeah.
Baz, he scores. I can't.
Oh no, Baz! What's happening? You don't play good.
No,
there are
well.
Better teams out there. Seriously, we're new. They are old teams. I think.
I mean, old. They don't have skills. Maybe you're new guys. What's happening?
We're new guys. We eventually we will. Hopefully this 30th. Yeah, we got a tournament.
How long do you play though? Is it like a proper time?
Tournament is proper 15 minutes each per game. It's about 8, 9, 10 teams, which comes from Old Borough of Tamlets. And yeah, we have a full competition with like Winners' Cup and medals and everything. Mm.
Good. 5 years' time, where do you think you see yourself?
Well, we live in Tower Hamlets, and this is my home, and I see myself still here, God willing, and just doing something in my community that will be a positive influence in my community. And just hopefully passing that on to my children. So as my eldest daughter is now going to Sir John Cass Secondary School, and so we don't see ourselves moving, and just saying to her, how can you be a positive influence in your school, within your friends, within the clubs that you may attend, and just passing hopefully that on to my children. We've got two children in St. Peter's School, the same thing for them. Yeah, so...
Do you visit like one another? Like, I'm talking about the football team members.
Yes.
Do you visit their home? Do you get to know the kids? Do you... It's quite an amazing stories you guys sharing, honestly. It's like a very close, bonded friends, you know, been there for a really long time, sounds like. So do you visit one another?
I think we try to. It doesn't always happen just with schedules and that kind of thing. So at Christmas time, for example, we're having just our house open to all kind of neighbours and friends and invited some of the team around, but they couldn't make it. But often things off the back of football. So if we're already playing in the kind of in the same space, well, let's go out for a coffee afterwards, or let's have lunch together afterwards. That works. Mm. And the dragon boat racing, whatever it was, the boat racing in Shabbat, that was great. Bringing the children along so we could all kind of meet one another. That was fun.
I think what I enjoyed as well was during Ramadan, once the guys broke their fast, they invited us to share a meal with them, and just to see them break their fast as well. And that was just for me, that was just something I really enjoyed.
Sir, I come to you again with the difficult ones all the time. You shouldn't sit there. Okay, what have you learned from that multi-group of footballers? What have you learned? Like, you're playing with about 24 people.
Yeah.
Yeah. You haven't met them before. Everyone's got different culture, so they have some good, amazing stuff. Every culture has that. So what have you learned mixing with them and learning? What did you learn?
I learned there's no racism in the football or any kind of background, there's no racism. And we should all teach that to our kids as well, not to be racist to anyone, or even be racist, like someone to be racist with you. Do not tolerate that. Tell your teacher or tell your father, parents, and they should deal with it whatever they can do. Yeah.
Imagine, I mean, and we have an issue, like, we have a timing problem. Asians have a timing problem. You know, it's true, because you've been playing football. One thing with you guys is amazing on time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's amazing.
Our timetable is fantastic.
It's so wrong to do it, but we all know, too lazy, all right.
Thursday football, 9:30, we all gather around, the gate opens, we go inside, 9:45 we start till 11. Brilliant. It's like proper 1 hour good football. Yeah.
The Bing,
the times were good.
they learn a hard lesson that, on a Monday, Tuesday we play at George Green Secondary School, and we have to be in the school at 9:45, and anyone who turns up after 9:45 is not allowed in the school because they're not allowed to walk through. And the first week there was a few Bengali guys standing there waving at us trying to come in, and after that week they learned their lesson, so they can do it.
That's great. You know, we're going to have a small break, inshallah. Dear viewers, we were talking about how to upbring our kids and father's role in their life as well. I think we all need to play a role. So if you have any experience, you could phone in and share. So I'm still waiting for a call as well. We can take a few calls. Robert, I know we were talking about if you're injured, they don't leave you in the floor. They take you where you're supposed to be. Do you have, in the beginning, I'm sure, the culture difference we had, because plenty of people coming from a different way, different places. They have assumption of doing how to do these things. Was it difficult to adjust everybody and bring him into a table?
I think it can be. I think part of the difficulty can be if someone does something different from you, you can think they are doing it because they don't like you. Or I do things this way, and if you're doing it that way, you are only doing it that way because you don't like me, you're trying to annoy me. But having got together, having played together more frequently, got to know one another, if people do things differently, it's not because they're trying to annoy you or whine, it's just because they do things differently. So I think just, again, sharing the same space breaks down suspicion and barriers. So if someone doesn't pass the ball to me, it's not because I'm white, it's just because they're as bad a passer as I am, for example. We're clumsy old men. That's why. I mean, it's those kinds of things. And being open to listen, to learn from one another, but also saying, actually, I'm quite happy the way I do things, but I'm not going to judge you necessarily for how you do things.
Fantastic. The viewers, stay with us. We're just going to go for a small break, inshallah. Don't go too far. I'll see you after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.